Penguin Random House Audio presents Subculture Vulture, a memoir in six scenes. This is the author, Moshe Kasher. To FCK, this is all for you. Introduction. Part of growing up is realizing that you haven't been walking a straight road to where you are now, that it's been a labyrinth the whole time. It's only in hindsight that you see how twisted the path has been. I wrote my first memoir in 2009, a chronicle of addiction and ridiculousness that ended when I was 15 and left rehab for the last time. I was a kid. That was almost 30 years ago, and now I'm a grown-up, I guess, despite the fact that my generation was the first to stop growing up altogether. Since that book came out, I've thought a lot about what happened next. How did I escape the chaos that was my life? How did I go from there to here? This is my attempt to turn that chaos into a story. But it's not one story. It's six. I've lived a lot of lives, and yes, I do wonder if it's possible to write I've lived a lot of lives without you rolling your eyes and dismissing me as a pretentious fuck. I sure hope so, because I've lived a lot of lives. I have spent my life being seduced by the charms of groups, of subcultures, of tiny communities. I have at times been a professional raver slash DJ slash ecstasy dealer, a boy king of Alcoholics Anonymous surrounded by throngs of other confused young people getting sober, a Burning Man attendee and then employee stuffing the psychedelic sausage, a conflicted but proud Jew attempting to make sense of the ultra-Hasidic world I'd been raised in, an American sign language interpreter who was at once both insider and outsider in the deaf community, and what I am today, a stand-up comedian, which is the thing that eventually became my living and the reason I have enough cultural cachet to be writing a book at all. Each segment contains a ramshackle history of the worlds I have inhabited, starting at the beginning and examining how they came to be. I actually did a lot of research to tell these histories, but I'm not a historian, so don't expect any groundbreaking discoveries about the author of the Bible or the guy who invented trance music. At a certain point in each of these histories, I intersect with the world I'm describing and tell the story of how these communities became a part of my DNA. Laid on top of one another, these six stories become one. They become my story, the history of me. Laid on top of one another, they become, once again, a labyrinth. So let's start in the center of the maze, where the way out seemed the most opaque, where the path forward seemed the most twisted, where I despaired of ever finding my way again. Let's start where my last book ended, the day I got sober, freshly broken, fully lost, and sure my life was over. It had just begun. Scene 1. AA, or 10,000 Days at a Time. On December 25th, 1994, I took my last drink. I was 15 years old. Getting sober at 15 sucks. Getting sober at 15 on Christmas sucks more. Getting sober on Christmas as a Jew is more or less neutral. It neither sucks, nor does it not suck. I didn't have to worry about how to make it through a Christmas family gathering sober, staring wistfully at the bowl of eggnog, wishing it was spiked. But I did have to worry about New Year's Eve. Getting sober on Christmas sucks because, by virtue of the unchangeable nature of the calendar, you will be, should you make it, 6 days sober on the most important drinking night of the year, New Year's Eve, amateur night. I knew that even if I made it to December 31st, I wouldn't make it any further. I was doomed before I started. Of course, I was getting ahead of myself, as I am now. I should start at the beginning, the day I quit, day one. Actually, no, I should start before the beginning, the days I tried and failed to get sober, when I'd quit and then immediately unquit the second I felt a craving, the second I felt anything at all. I should start there, before I stopped. That's the real beginning. Actually, no, I should start before then, at the real, real beginning, June 10th, 1935. That's the day Dr. Robert Smith, an Akron-based proctologist and lead singer of The Cure, took his last drink and got sober with the help of Bill Wilson, a failed New York stockbroker. the birth date of Alcoholics Anonymous. Or I guess we should start before that. How's April 2nd, 1840? That's when six alcoholics founded a mutual aid society, the Washingtonians, and found a way to stop drinking by helping one another. Shoot, I don't know where to start. Let's go back to the beginning of human history, when one caveman looked at another caveman as he wiped fermented saber-toothed tiger piss off his beard and said, "Og, you think you might have drinking problem?" Seemingly, from the time humankind learned the counterintuitive process of rotting a beverage to make it taste worse and you feel better, there have been those who lost control. The drunks, the addicts, the lushes, your dad, me. Throughout this section, I will be using the terms alcoholic and addict, drugs and alcohol, and high and drunk interchangeably. Until the 1940s, alcoholics were thought of as lost causes, not worth the time or energy it took to try to help them, because they never took that help. They never stopped. They always, every time, broke your heart and never got better. If you had the bad luck of marrying a drunk, you had few choices. Pray for a miracle of healing, kill your spouse, pray for the miracle of your spouse spontaneously dying. The dead spouse option was by far the most likely to occur. Alcoholics were doomed. Then came Sigmund Freud, who said, "Alcoholics aren't doomed, they're gay." Not kidding. I'm barely even paraphrasing. Freud postulated that problem drinkers were merely latent homosexuals, drinking to cover that up. And all the drunk needed was to submit to a full battery of Freudian analysis, integrate the self, and he would emerge sober, thirsty only for vagina. If you can believe it, Freud's theories did not make a huge impact on recovery rates for alcoholism. By and large, heading into the 1930s, hospitals straight up wouldn't treat alcoholics, refused at the door. Alcoholism was seen as a moral failure, a weakness of the will. Medicine couldn't treat that any more than it could treat a chronic thief. If a drunk was particularly bad off, they might get thrown into the loony bin for a night and tossed out on their asses in the morning. But that was about it. There were some exceptions. In New York City, an alcoholic could get dedicated inpatient help at a comically dangerous clinic called the Towns Hospital. Charles B. Towns was a former life insurance salesman with zero medical training who just opened a fucking hospital because I guess you could do that back then. The Towns Hospital was a high-priced clinic for well-to-do drunkards and junkies who could afford to pay the upfront fee for a cushy five-day stay, which included a round of Mr. Towns' notorious belladonna treatment, the recipe to which, and I'm not making this up, was given to him by a mysterious stranger who said he discovered a compound that would cure alcoholism. It was a noxious cocktail of, and I'm not making this up, equal doses of deadly nightshade and insane root. You'd hallucinate, puke and purge, and when you started taking, and I'm once again not making this up, big watery shits, they figured you were ready for discharge. Physical, not rectal. Towns Hospital self-reported a cure rate of 90% based on, and I swear I'm not even making this up, assuming patients who never returned to the hospital had been cured. I guess it never occurred to Mr. Towns that perhaps dying of alcoholism was preferable to riding the snake of the insane root and diarrhea treatment. It was about this time that a new idea began to formulate around the just what is wrong with alcoholics conundrum. What if they were not constitutionally weak reprobates? What if they were sick? The head physician of Towns Hospital, William D. Silkworth, a man whose name sounds like a stoned caterpillar in a psychedelic 1970s animated film, began to describe alcoholism as a disease rather than a moral failing. This idea eventually took a hold of the American understanding of what it meant to be an alcoholic and addict. These were not bad people struggling to be good. They were sick people trying to get well. By the time I hit my first AA meeting in 1993, barely 14 years old and fresh out of my first rehab, this idea was well integrated into the American cultural understanding of substance abuse. It was a foregone conclusion. But back then, no one agreed with Silkworth. His contemporaries scoffed at the idea of disease as anything more than a useful metaphor. And it took a national movement and the full sustained lobbying force of the National Council on Alcoholism to get the psychological community to submit to the disease model. The truth is, it's hard to know what addiction really is. It's a kind of limbo problem, neither psychological disorder nor not, neither physical malady nor not, neither moral failing nor not. It's easier to describe what it is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.